Welcome to the Jet Setter Show, where we explore lifestyle-friendly destinations worldwide. Enjoy and learn from a variety of experts on topics ranging from upscale travel at wholesale prices to retiring overseas, to global real estate and business opportunities, to tax havens and expatriate opportunities. You'll get great ideas on unique cultures, causes, and cruise vacations. Whether you're wealthy or just want to live a wealthy lifestyle, the Jet Setter Show is for you. Here's your host, Jason Hartman.
Welcome to the Jet Setter Show. This is Jason Hartman, your host, where we explore lifestyle-friendly destinations worldwide. I think you'll enjoy the interview we have for you today, and we will be back with that in less than 60 seconds here on the Jet Setter Show.
Now's your opportunity to get the Financial Freedom Report. The Financial Freedom Report provides financial self-defense in uncertain times, and it's your source for innovative, forward-thinking investment property strategies and advice. Get your newsletter subscription today. You get a digital download and even more. Go to jasonhartman.com to get yours today.
Hey, it's my pleasure to welcome Kevin Wessel to the show. He is an expert on asset protection. His firm is a firm that trains attorneys on how to do asset protection, although he is not an attorney himself. And he'll talk about some offshore stuff that's kind of our focus in the interview, but maybe talk about some domestic stuff within the United States as well, if you like. Kevin, it's a pleasure to have you on the show. How are you?
Oh, it's a pleasure, Jason. Nice talking with you.
Likewise. So you're coming to us today from Santa Clarita, California, right?
Santa Clarita, California, just north of Los Angeles.
Fantastic. Beautiful place. Tell us, first of all, just quickly, I mean, I think most of our listeners know why they'd want to consider asset protection, especially offshore. But, you know, maybe just give a little primer on it real quickly, if you would.
Well, the answer is that the United States has 5% of the world's population, 70% of the world's lawyers, and 96% of the world's lawsuits. And the legal profession is a business, and attorneys are in the business of maximizing their billable hours, and as such, habitually oversell their clients on the chances of not losing the case in order to keep their own financial clocks running. So by setting up an asset protection strategy, it takes the target off one's back and makes one much less of an attractive target to sue.
Yeah, no question about it. So in terms of the litigation problem, we know the U.S. is plagued with litigation problems. I think that's really costing our overall country's productivity. Our overall GDP is really being hurt by that because, you know, we're so busy suing each other in this country that we could be doing more productive things. So it's just sort of sad that that's the current state of affairs. But anything also on the governmental aspect of it, you know, last year, the Obama administration attacked UBS and all of those Swiss bank accounts. And it seems that a broke, insolvent, bankrupt government, which is basically what we have, is reaching everywhere they can around the world to get money. Do you think there's a concern about governmental money grabs here in the U.S., and this might be another reason to consider it?
Well, there possibly is. We don't intentionally set up asset protection to protect assets from the U.S. government. But the legal system allowed by the U.S. government is the most litigious in the world by far. I mean, when you consider the statistics we just talked about, 96% of the world's lawsuits happen here, and that's as a result of our laws that are enacted by our government.
No question about it. When you look around the world, there is so much difference of opinion on this, Kevin, in terms of where someone should set up an entity. What type of entity do they need? And you know, why? So can you maybe start with, I think there are basically three types of offshore entities people want to think about, right? An international business corporation, an LLC, and an offshore trust, right? Does that cover the gamut?
Yep. That's right. And the first thing that we need to do is really set the framework, because some people hearing this may feel uncomfortable going offshore. In the United States, we're a little bit isolated because we have a country to the north, Canada. It's a very similar culture, depend on us, same language except the French portion. To the south, Mexico, they kind of really depend on us economically quite a bit, and a lot of people want to come here. And their effort is bent toward learning English rather than the other way around because of the economic dependency. And so we are kind of isolated here, and it's almost like back in the days the Europeans, when they had drawn maps of the world, they didn't know what was beyond the stretches of the ocean they could see, so they had drawn sea monsters around the edge. So not knowing what's over in Europe or Asia, as far as the banking world goes, a lot of times people will create scary monsters in their heads because of the unknown mind. I've traveled internationally, and I've gone into, I've walked down Bahnhofstrasse, the street with the most banks in Switzerland, in Zurich, and have found very, very well-organized, safe institutions. In fact, if you look at the safest banks in the world, you type safest banks in the world in Google, you'll find that a very low percentage of those banks are actually in the United States.
Well, in the U.S., they're so leveraged, and the fractional reserve banking Ponzi scheme in the U.S. is just, it's crazy.
Yeah. In fact, out of the top 50 safest banks in the world, if you look at the Global Finance article, only less than 20% of the banks are in the United States, the safest banks being in Germany, Netherlands, Switzerland, and in some of the Asian countries. So the thinking that, oh, it's, you know, the banking is only safe in the U.S., well, somebody really better think again and look online and see that that's certainly not the case. It's the safest banks are actually outside the U.S. It's not, oh, is banking offshore safe? Is banking in the U.S. safe?
But everybody has always looked at the U.S. as being kind of the Brinks truck, if you will, where, you know, even if the banks aren't safe, the government will back them. But, you know, I'd sort of argue nowadays that is the government safe? I mean, you know, what's the government going to back the banks with? A bunch of fake printed money that creates a lot of inflation ultimately. But that's the state of affairs. That's the way the world is. And none of us are likely to change it. So all we can do is react to it and kind of manage that risk. Before we get into the three different types of entities and why does someone need an entity at all? I mean, you can't just call up a bank in Switzerland as a U.S. citizen and open a bank account. They won't take you, right?
Yeah, most cases they won't. Most banks won't. They want to have the bank account open up in a foreign entity name, and that's beneficial for several reasons. One, it gives the ability to open the account. Two, it keeps the money out of one's own personal name, and you send a wire transfer from your name in the U.S. to your name, sure, it's pretty obvious whose money it is, and that's for lawsuit protection purpose. Naturally, we want to be tax and legally compliant, so we want to make sure to do those things properly. But, you know, somebody wants to have privacy with their funds to be less of a target for these crazy lawsuits that we're suffering in the U.S. Having the bank account in the company name offers that additional benefit of privacy. Plus, if it's in a limited liability company, there are provisions in the law such that when somebody is sued, whatever is in the LLC can be protected from being taken away from that person. So there's additional asset protection as well.
Okay. So will any country just allow a U.S. citizen to open a bank account at all, or has the whole world sort of closed business to U.S. citizens? And that's why, you know, other than the advantages you mentioned, you need an entity in order to bank offshore.
It's perfectly legal and acceptable widely done to have an account internationally for a U.S. person. It's perfectly legal.
Right, but can you get a bank to let you open an account? That's really the question.
Yes. There are banks that will let you open up an account, and naturally, as they should, they do background checks to make sure they're dealing with a person who's is a reputable person. In other words, doesn't have a criminal background and so on, as that should be the case, and that is the case. But as long as somebody's operating a clean, honest, upstanding business, they can certainly open up an account internationally. And we know the institutions because I've personally been doing this for 21 years. We know the institutions that are the best to work with, the most convenient, have online access, and so on.
And talk to us about those three entities and which one is used for what and why.
Well, we have a lot of information on our website, offshorecompany.com. And so more detailed information can be obtained. In addition, it would be wise for me to add that the information we're talking about here shouldn't be considered tax or legal advice for any specific person. This is informational purposes that we're discussing here, and you know, somebody can obtain specific legal advice from their attorney or tax advice from their accountant. That being said, let's talk about the corporation. International corporations have been used for years by large companies like we mentioned, Microsoft, Boeing, IBM. They all have international companies to operate their businesses. Perfectly legal for you and me to own and operate our businesses in that fashion and hold funds offshore. stepping over to the LLC, that provides one step up in protection, because not only is it can one hold their funds privately in an LLC, but LLCs have the additional provision of asset protection, so that when you're sued, your membership, there are provisions in the law, so the membership is protected from being taken away, including the assets, the bank account inside the LLC. So you have the asset protection when it's an LLC, which is a superior entity for asset protection purposes. For example, an LLC in the Caribbean island of Nevis is a very good choice. It's a little island by St. Kitts and Nevis, form one country. Beautiful place. I've been there, and we've been setting up companies there for, about 20 years. And then with the nice thing to know is that you don't have to open the bank account there. So the safest banks in the world are actually in Europe and Asia. The top on the world safest bank list, the top rated U.S. bank is only number 25 on the list. So if you want to put your money in a safer place, put it in one of these banks in Europe or Asia and put it into an LLC, so you have the extra asset protection. A Nevis LLC can have a bank account in Switzerland. Doesn't have to be in the same jurisdiction. Now, the next entity or structure we'll talk about is an international trust.
Let me ask you a question before you leave the LLC. So in terms of cost, the LLC is that the least expensive, or is an IBC about the same, the International Business Corporation?
The International Business Corporation, LLC, typically run are similar in cost. Depending on the entity, it can run an average of maybe $1,500. An attorney might charge $5,000. We do a wholesale rate, so we're a lot better price.
Yeah, no, your rates seem pretty competitive. They really do. An LLC is a relatively new thing in the U.S. I mean, an LLC is what, about 15 years old, the whole idea of LLCs here in the States? I was kind of surprised to learn that they have them offshore. Have they been around a long time offshore? I mean, corporations have been around forever, but LLCs are relatively new, aren't they?
Well, yeah, the first LLC statutes in the United States were in Wyoming in 1977.
Oh, so they're not as new as I thought they were. I thought they were like in the early 90s or something.
Yeah, and then in 1994, right around there, many states across the country, if not all, enacted LLC statutes. So right around 94, 95, they started to spread, and other states had them. But 1977 is when they first started in the United States. Yeah. Other jurisdictions, well, there is some South American jurisdictions that had LLCs before the United States did. So they're very, very good in terms of, and the reason that they offer asset protection is, you think of building a skyscraper. You know, it's pretty difficult for any one person to have enough money to build that big thing. And so these LLC statutes were enacted, similar to limited partnership statutes, to encourage a lot of people to pitch their money in together and build these substantial structures. It'd be hard for one person to do. Now, if one of those people in the LLC were sued and rear-ended somebody in their car on Saturday night, and they were sued for more than their insurance covers, well, it wouldn't be fair to, if there are 100 investors, for the other 99 people to lose their investment just because that one person had gotten the car wreck. You know, it would discourage people from pitching their money in the same pool and building substantial structures or businesses and so on. So they said, okay, here's what we'll do. No matter who is sued, if somebody is a member of an LLC, the asset inside the LLC is safe and secure, and it can't be touched just because one of the people are sued. And that will encourage joint commerce and building significant businesses and structures. So the nice thing is one or two people or a family can take advantage of the same laws that a conglomerate can take advantage of. So the asset inside can't be taken away just because one of the people are sued.
Right, but that's the same applies to shareholders in a corporation, right?
Well, with the corporation, except for Nevada and in Wyoming, enacted similar statutes, those two states. If a shareholder is sued, the shares of stock can be taken away from that individual, except for Nevada statutes are the strongest. So the shares can't be taken away.
Because that's what you call the charging order protection, right?
The charging order protection they offer in Nevada is very strong, and that applies to LLCs in just about all 50 states and to corporations in Nevada.
How about Wyoming? Because I know Wyoming's really good like that. Is that true?
Yeah, Wyoming, they adopted similar statutes.
Yeah, okay. Right? So the LLC really is a much better asset protection vehicle than a corporation then, right?
It is, yes.
Yeah. Okay. Good to know. Yeah, that's good. That's a good way you explain that distinction. Okay, so you want to talk about trust now, right?
Yeah, trust. The asset protection trusts are some of the strongest legal tools in the world when it comes to protecting one's net worth, and it especially works well when somebody has liquid assets and is held in an international account. Now, the strongest asset protection in the world is, in our opinion, in the Cook Islands, which is south of Hawaii. It's in the same time zone, and Cook Islands have the strongest case law history in the world. So in cases where it's been challenged, it's not just a theory, but every time it's been tested, it's protected the client's assets from lawsuits. Now, the local courts say, give me the money, and the trustee who resides outside of the U.S. jurisdiction does not need to comply because he's not bound by local court orders. Now, so the client can control the day-to-day activities. We establish a limited liability company, for example, in Nevis, down in the Caribbean, that is 100% owned by the trust. Now, the client can be the initial manager of the Nevis LLC, and the LLC has the bank accounts and is the signatory on the accounts that the client is. Now, when the bad thing happens, this trustee can step in not only as the trustee of the trust, but also manager of the LLC that's inside the trust, that's owned by the trust. Now, the trustee is licensed and bonded, and by licensed we mean they've gone through intensive background checks to get a license, and by bonded we mean the funds are insured, plus we use a 30-plus-year-old trust company. So, for client safety and peace of mind, the only time the trustee steps in is when the courts would take the money. So, the question is, would you rather have a 100% chance of the money being taken by the courts, or would you rather have a licensed, bonded trustee who's never taken a client's money do what you paid them to do, and that's protect your money? Now, when the bad thing happens, and you can read more about this on our website, offshorecompany.com, when the bad thing happens, when the bad thing goes away, the string of control, which is the management of the Nevis LLC, goes back to you, and you're back in the driver's seat with all your money intact. And then in the meantime, if you have bills to pay, the trustee can pay them for you. You can have the trustee pay a trusted friend or relative who provides the money to you. So in other words, you have access to the money, but the courts do not. And the bottom line is everything you've worked so hard is for is safe and secure. I mean, trusts have been around for hundreds of years. You know, back in the 1400s, they were used in England. The best asset protection that the trust provides for is for liquid assets held offshore. So a U.S. judge has jurisdiction over U.S. bank accounts and real estate. So you can put your U.S. real estate in the Nevis LLC that's owned by the trust, or record a lien against the property payable to the Nevis LLC. But when the bad thing happens, it's better to sell the real estate and liquidate it than to lose it altogether. So that's really the strongest asset protection in the world is the Cook Islands Trust, in our opinion.
Right. The only thing is, and I tell you, I'm sure a lot of listeners are thinking the same thing I am, is I have a really tough time relinquishing control of my money and assets to somebody else, to a trustee. Now, you know, I know the things you mentioned, but gosh, even then, any thoughts on that? Any more thoughts besides what you mentioned?
Yeah, certainly. And the key thing is, you know, the reputation of the trust company is important. And the nice thing is the trustee we use is licensed. And they're bonded, so if anything happens, the insurance company covers the funds.
But it's an insurance company in the Cook Islands, or
no? It's an insurance company in the UK. Now, one thing there is, keep in mind, the reason why we put the company, the Nevis LLC, inside the trust is so that the client can control the funds and be the only signatory on the account until the bad thing happens. Now, when the bad thing happens, if the client wants the trustee to step in, or the client or the trustee steps in because they need to, that would be a case where the money would be taken anyway. So it's kind of like, would you rather have a 100% chance of the money being taken by the courts, or would you rather have a licensed, bonded trustee who's never taken a client's money in history, 30-plus years, do simply what you've paid them to do?
Yeah.
And so when you think of that, the money would be gone anyway. It's a pretty little risk to have a trustee, you know, step in and that's what they do, and that's what they are paid to do.
So then the next entity we move to, now offshore trust, any price ranges you wanted to mention, or is that something they should just find out by contacting you?
They can give us a call. They can give us a call and ask questions, that, you know, visit our website first, and they can then give us a call, because it's quite a fraction of what attorneys charge. We actually set up a lot of these for attorneys, and we do it for a wholesale rate, and we can do the same for the people who call.
Right, right. And but people should know that the trust is quite a bit more involved and more expensive than an LLC or an international business corporation, right?
Oh, yeah, sure. Okay. And it's really the strongest legal tool in the world. We've never had a client lose money that's had money in an international endeavor.
One question I want to ask you before you move on. There are ongoing costs in maintaining these entities every year, right?
Yes, there are. It's real reasonable. You know, naturally, the trustee needs to keep their lights on, and there's an annual government fee, but it's real reasonable.
And, you know, any thought on the difference between LLC, IBC, and trust on those maintenance fees every year? I mean, all of them have maintenance fees with them, right?
Oh, yeah. They all do. It's real reasonable, and you talk to an accountant about it being tax deductible as well, so it's quite reasonable, especially when you're, you know, protecting your hard-earned assets.
Sure. Okay. Let's talk about the last of the three entities, then the IBC or the International Business Corporation.
Yeah, the International Business Corporation would be more utilized for people who want to actually operate a business, not just protect assets. That would be the more common use. So somebody, we've had clients, for example, we had a client down in the Caribbean. They wanted to form a company that gives little submarine rides around the harbor to look at sea life and so on. So that would be an example. They used a corporation, international corporation, for that particular reason. And in that case, we set up a company that could legally operate locally. So that was more of a local Caribbean company. That was this particular one, I believe, was either in the Cayman Islands or the Bahamas.
When it comes to the International Business Corporation, that's for an operating business, not a place to just store assets. And what's involved in setting that up? Where do you want to do it? And, you know, anything you want to mention on fees for that would be fine if you'd like to share.
Oh, sure. Well, for example, Nevis is a good place for international corporations as well as the LLCs. The preferable one is the LLC for most people. British Virgin Islands is real common. Belize is also, you know, real good choice as well. So those are some of the jurisdictions that seem to be favorable, and we've set up thousands and thousands of these entities in these different jurisdictions. We set up companies worldwide, but those are some of the most popular and offer the most benefits.
And why can't someone operate a business with an LLC? Why is that not for operating a business?
Well, someone can operate a business with an LLC as well, so that would actually be, it depends on the type of business that they're operating.
Right, but it's better with the IBC, right?
Typically, in my opinion, it is more favorable for the U.S. person to have an LLC if they're operating a business or holding assets, in my opinion. Now, there may be some restrictions if it's a publicly traded company, but that would be the question to ask a securities attorney.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I don't think anybody listening has to worry too much about that.
No.
You know, that's sort of a whole different arena. Do you, just out of curiosity, are you finished talking about the IBC?
Yes.
Okay, great. So just some questions for you. First one is, some entity formation groups like yours, they do things like they help people with dual citizenship, getting a passport in a foreign country. Do you deal with anything like that?
We can help with that aspect as well. I mean, it's not a common thing that people want, but it is something that some people want. That is certainly something that we can do.
And how does the banking work? Say, for example, myself or one of our listeners was to set up an LLC in Nevis and or an international business corporation. How do they bank, and especially if it's an IBC, an entity that's an operating entity, how do they bank and do business in the U.S. with that entity?
Well, if it is actually operating with employees, a physical location, we file a foreign qualification to do business in that particular state where they're located. If it's just an internet business and they're kind of acting as an independent contractor on behalf of that company over yonder, that may be a different case. Somebody should get tax and legal advice on that. But a lot of people operate internet businesses using international structures.
And when it comes down to the daily issue of banking and being able to pay bills and spend money and use credit or debit cards, writing checks, how is that managed? How do you do it?
Well, these accounts will, typically have a debit card associated with them and online access, wire funds here and there. Checks not so much, but checks aren't really used that much in international jurisdictions anyway. Like hardly ever see a check in Europe nowadays. It's mainly electronically and through debit cards. But it's just as convenient as almost as convenient as the bank down the street when you consider online access.
And does that debit or credit card associated with a bank account work in the United States? And
it'll have like a Visa or MasterCard logo, and they can use it to buy a loaf of bread at Walmart.
Uh-huh. Okay. And does it work online in the United States? Because I've heard that there are some problems with that. In fact, there was a 60 Minutes story just a few months ago, and I heard that the law just very recently changed just a few months ago, because a lot of the terrorist organizations and money launderers were using like gift cards and prepaid Visa cards and other debit cards and things. And nowadays, I heard that they made it much harder to use those cards at websites. So say, for example, you operate a business in the U.S., you have an IBC that's in Nevis, for example, and you have your debit card or credit card. Which one is it, by the way? Would it be either? Or?
Either one is available. There's debit and credit cards both are available.
And then you try to buy things and have subscriptions to services that you use on various websites, and it doesn't work. I mean, is that a problem now, or have you overcome that problem?
We haven't seen that at all. The one area that is if somebody wanted to use it for like online gaming or something like that, that would be something that wouldn't be legal. There are restrictions.
That's got a whole set of other problems with it. But just for buying things, regular stuff.
Yeah, I've never ever seen a client have a problem buying things with their international debit card. And when you mentioned the terrorism thing, keep in mind that. It's not these entities are terrorism magnets. It's anybody can use things like Boots to walk into the store or walk into a store or a bank and rob it. So it's not the things themselves or the car that somebody drives to commit act.
Yeah.
It's the person.
Yeah, of course it is. Yeah, I mean, I agree with you, and that's why I'm not a big gun control advocate, because, it's not the guns that are doing it, it's the people. Okay, then in terms of an operating business, in terms of an IBC, one of the things I like to do, and I'll just use myself as an example, is I love to invest in real estate. I think income property is far and away the very best asset class really in the world. And my sort of number two favorite is to do hard money lending, short-term hard money lending on properties where, I'm getting upwards of 12% and it's real short-term, they're 4 or 6 months long, that type of thing. Can I do this through an international entity like an LLC or an IBC? I guess I can get it qualified in the U.S., but are there problems and obstacles to doing that? The reason I ask you this is that a lot of times you don't find this stuff out until you really try and do it in real life. And that's the great thing about having an expert like yourself who's been doing it for so long, and you hear from your clients and their experiences.
Yeah, in fact, someone can set up an international company and register to do business in the U.S. You think of Hershey's chocolate as a good old American brand. Well, it's not. It's actually a European brand, a European corporation.
So, isn't that interesting?
International business is our biggest trading partner is China, and there's billions, if not trillions, of dollars going back and forth. It's just a way of life. So if somebody wants to operate an international NA in the U.S., many already are.
Good. And so you can do large transactions. I mean, do you recommend people hold real estate in any of these entities, U.S. real estate, or make U.S. hard money loans inside of these entities, or is that not the best purpose for them?
Well, they certainly can. I mean, in the U.S. real estate is under the jurisdiction of the U.S. courts. So liquid assets, if somebody's talking about asset protection, are better protected because they can be in an international institution. But someone can put their real estate in an international entity. There's certainly fine to do something like that. And there are certain reporting requirements. If somebody is a signatory on an international bank account, there's a Treasury Department form to fill out annually. If somebody owns an international company, but that's just a simple matter. If anybody who earns money has to fill out certain forms, and this is just a natural part of what we all need to do anyway.
Okay, good. What else would you like people to know?
Well, we'd like people to know that the international business and international accounts are perfectly legal, normal, as long as people are complying with the law, and that someone should look into it, and certainly will be able to get a comfort level that it's a good, safe thing to do. And it really is when you consider that the safest banks in the world, you know, type that in Google, world safest banks. And there's a article that shows, a very thorough article where the banks have been researched for their assets, and you'll see that the U.S. really isn't on it very much. Out of the top 50 banks, I only see three in the United States out of the top 50. So when people think, oh, wow, it's safe here, well, that's not the case anymore. It's not safe here anymore.
Yeah. No, I'm looking at the list right now myself, and it's amazing that number 36 is J.P. Morgan Chase. That's shocking. I mean, we know what they're up to, which is they're getting in all kinds of trouble. So good stuff. Give out your website once more and tell people where they can learn more, Kevin.
Yeah, visit us at offshorecompany.com, and we'd be very glad to help you. We offer, you know, free consultations, and if somebody has questions or need help, they can give us a call at 1-800-959-8819. Again, that's 1-800-959-8819. We'd be very glad to help answer any questions people may have.
Great. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you, Jason.
What's great about the shows you'll find on jasonhartman.com is that if you want to learn more about investing in real estate in different markets, there's a show for that. If you want to learn 17 ways rich people think and act differently, there's a show for that. If you want to know how to get paid to borrow, there's a show for that. And if you'd like to know why Amsterdam doesn't take dollars or why pools are for fools, there are even shows for that. Yep, there's a show for just about anything. Only from jasonhartman.com, or type in Jason Hartman in the iTunes store.
This show is produced by the Hartman Media Company, all rights reserved. For distribution or publication rights and media interviews, please visit www.hartmanmedia.com or email media@hartmanmedia.com. Nothing on this show should be considered specific personal or professional advice. Please consult an appropriate tax, legal, real estate, or business professional for individualized advice. Opinions of guests are their own, and the host is acting on behalf of Platinum Properties Investor Network, Inc., exclusively.